Well, good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the 24th meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2024. Agenda item one for the committee is to decide whether or not to take agenda items 3, 4, and 5 in private this morning. Are we agreed?
Agreed.
We are agreed. Thank you very much. Our main item of business this morning is consideration of the report into the National Fraud Initiative in Scotland 2024. Can I welcome our witnesses this morning who are joining us in the committee room? We've got John Connett, who's the Executive Director of Audit Services at Audit Scotland. John is joined by Tim Bridle, who's the Audit Manager at Audit Scotland. We've got some questions to put to you about the report, but before we get to that, John, could I invite you to make a short opening statement?
Thank you very much, Convener. The report that's in front of you today is our summary report from the National Fraud Initiative. The exercise was started in 22-23, and it runs every 2 years as we work through the cycle and complete the work and then complete the report. It is a high-level briefing document that sets the outcomes from the exercise, and it also provides a summary of the auditor assessments around the delivery arrangements, both for the exercise itself but also for individual bodies to respond to the data matches that come out of the exercise. The exercise itself, an NFI, is undertaken statutorily under powers that are contained within the Criminal Justice and Licensing Act 2010, Scotland, and also the Public Finance and Accountability Scotland Act of 2000. It is, though, a UK-wide exercise, a data matching exercise that takes place across all four nations in the UK, and it covers a range of areas, including council tax, housing benefits and public sector pensions, just to name a few of the areas that it covers. You'll see from the report itself that the outcomes have increased from £14.9 million reported in 2022 to £21.5 million reported as part of this exercise. There have been increased outcomes on a cash basis across most of the areas covered by the report, but it's also important to highlight there are some areas where outcomes have declined, particularly, for example, around single-person discounts for council tax. And there is an increase in the outcomes due to a change in the methodologies since the previous exercise was undertaken. The local auditors follow up on NFI governance arrangements as individual bodies that we audit and give a view as to the adequacy of those arrangements. And most auditors have concluded that those arrangements have remained sound over the period covered by this exercise, this 22-23 exercise. However, there are fewer bodies that have been assessed as having fully satisfactory arrangements than in previous exercises, and auditors have concluded that some bodies could do more to follow up data matches more effectively and more robustly. We continue to work with the Cabinet Office, who lead on the exercise nationally, Scottish Government, and other participating bodies as well, to help ensure that fraud is detected, prevented, and also deterred through the NFI exercise. Convener, that was all I was going to say by way of opening statement. Tim and I are more than happy to take any questions and explore any of the issues in the report in more detail.
Thank you very much for setting out that introductory statement, some of the kind of main issues that are contained in the report. We're going to get into quite a bit more detail over the course of the next hour or so. And I'm going to begin by inviting James Dornan to put some questions to you. James.
And good morning to the witnesses. The report states that 127 public bodies participated in the 22-23 NFI exercise compared to 132 public bodies in 2021. Do you know why there's been this slight reduction in the number of public bodies taking part?
The number of bodies that participate will vary depending upon the bodies that are mandated. Not all bodies are mandated. Some bodies voluntarily participate. And we extend the exercise to include those voluntary bodies that participate. They can change their mind, they can join and drop out as time progresses over a period of time. So it's not mandatory for everybody, and there are some voluntary bodies in there that can change their mind. Tim, I don't know if you know more of the detail on that.
Yeah, thanks, John. There's also different ways to count things. So I think in the previous exercise, we maybe had counted some pension funds as bodies. Technically, they're not bodies. So we've not done that this time. So there's probably a couple, two or three pension funds were included previously, which have not been counted as separate bodies this time as well.
Why would you include them at once in one report and not in the other? Is there a particular reason for that?
Well, I guess, you know, in terms of what constitutes a body, a pension fund is not necessarily, it's not a separate sort of legal entity in its own right. It's not a corporate body as such. It's a fund that's administered by a body. So we haven't counted them this time.
But if you were counting, I'm a bit confused with that, right? Because if you were counting anything one time, why would you think that the next time that you didn't need to involve the same sort of bodies?
I think the data is still included because the data has been collected and matched through the exercise. We just haven't identified that organisation as a separate individual body. So it's not as though the data has been excluded and there isn't therefore a reduction in the value of the data that's been matched. It's just how we've counted the number of organisations that participate.
Okay. To what extent do you consider all public bodies and private organisations in receipt of public money should participate in the NFI in line with the recommendation made by our predecessor committee in session 5?
I think it's a challenging question, and I think the issue is fundamentally the extent to which the powers under statute encompass different organisations. So it's arguable that you can construct an argument that the powers under statute apply to public sector bodies, and therefore we encourage as many public sector bodies to participate as they can. If you're starting to look to extend that into those bodies that are contracted by public sector bodies to provide services, there is an element where some of the data is captured, but the ability to apply the requirements of the Act become reduced in terms of how that works through. So it becomes a voluntary participation at that point rather than a mandated participation.
I can see the argument for the difficulty in, when it's somebody that's been contracted to do work with public monies. But, for example, no universities have volunteered to participate in the 24-25 NFI. Why would that be? I mean, they are publicly funded.
We are working with colleges and universities to encourage further participation. It is a voluntary exercise for the universities. One of the challenges that we have is to understand and mitigate against the conflict that might exist with GDPR requirements. And there are some bodies that have concerns about how GDPR applies. So it is a conversation that we've worked through. It is something that we're liaising with the Cabinet Office on to get the clarity around GDPR in order to provide the assurances to bodies in terms of how the data can and may be used as part of the exercise.
So who decides that it's okay for universities to volunteer or not volunteer to participate, as opposed to them being a public body paid for by public funds and therefore should be part of this?
There is, it fundamentally comes down to the individual body as to whether they want to participate in the exercise or not, and we have no power to mandate participation.
I'll tell you on, but about mandated and voluntary organisations. So I take it there are some mandated organisations?
Yes, most public bodies participate because of the requirements of the Act that applies to us.
I suppose that's the question I'm asking then, is why universities are not part of the mandated group.
Universities don't fall within our public audit regime, so we don't audit universities.
So in that case then it has to be voluntary. Okay. And the last question I've got then is kind of similar. It's about housing associations. We know that while you're working with several interested housing associations, it's unclear how many will actually participate. Do you have an update on how many have volunteered to participate in the next exercise?
It's a similar answer to my previous answer. The issue with the housing associations has been seeking clarity around how GDPR applies and whether there is a conflict between the requirements that we apply with NFI and how GDPR would apply in a housing association position. Again, we're working with the Cabinet Office to get clarity on that, and hopeful to be able to move that forward quite quickly.
Can I ask you then, just for my knowledge, nothing else, how does GDPR impact on you seeing if fraud is taking place?
The exercise that we go through isn't a fraud exercise, it's a data matching exercise, which may highlight an error or may highlight fraud. It is body's data that we are using, it's not our own data, so we have to have due care and attention to actually how we use the data we collect from them. There are concerns, and the individual bodies have concerns about whether or not providing that data puts them in breach of GDPR, and we are looking to get clarity around that in terms of how that might apply. As I say, we're working with Cabinet Office around that. Tim, do you have more detail on that?
I think that's a fair summary, John, to be honest. So the fundamental difference is that for a mandated body, it's a public task and they don't really have a choice. So the gateways involved in UK GDPR compliance are different for a mandated body. It's a much more complex equation for a voluntary participating body. So where we've invited voluntary participation on a pilot basis for RSLs, it's not the same gateway, and it's more complicated. So we are finding that is a key challenge for them, and to some extent a barrier, because they're not a mandated body, because they fall out with our audit regime. So that's the crux of the issue, really, is they're not mandated.
Just one final question based on that then. For how long have you been trying to get this issue around GDPR sorted?
Probably for the last 9 months, we've been working with RSLs. We've spoken to Information Commissioner Office in Scotland, and been liaising with the Cabinet Office, around the legal advice. So sometime it's a thorny issue, and ultimately it may well be it's the housing association that is accountable to Information Commissioner on UK GDPR. It's their decision. It's a voluntary basis, and if it's for them to either accept or reject our assurances in terms of UK GDPR.
So it's a case of the dots not really been joined up then.
I'm not sure I would go that far. I think it's a complex regulatory framework, is what I would say. And as I say, it's distinctly different from a mandated body to a voluntary participant. It's different principles involved. One is a public task, and one is to do with legitimate interests and proportionality. It's quite different, as I understand it. I'm not a solicitor, I should say.
If I may, I think it's more a question of not necessarily the dots being joined up. It's more about making sure that we get it right rather than make assumptions and presumptions in the exercise. So I'd rather delay it a little and get it right than rush it through. And
really aimed at something that you were doing right or wrong. It was the circumstances are that some public bodies are having to are mandated to do this. Some that are accessing public funds or not, and there's gaps there. That means that the information must be given from this public body, but it doesn't have to be given from this publicly funded organisation. Yeah. So, okay, listen, thanks very much for that.
Thank you. I think Graeme Simpson wants to come in with a quick question.
There's a couple of questions, if you don't mind, convener. I just wanted to be clear in my head how this actually operates in practice. So you've got all these bodies taking part, sharing information about people. So how does it actually work? Is it a constant sharing of information, computer systems talking to each other, and then at some point somebody will flash up on a screen as having done something wrong, or is it people sort of pouring through documents trying to sort of join dots and pick up fraud?
Tim is much closer to the detail of that than I am, so I'll hand over to Tim in a moment. But fundamentally, it's a one-off exercise that takes place every 2 years. The bodies that participate provide a download of their data from various systems, whether it's payroll system, council tax, accounts payable, whichever system it might be. They provide a download that goes to an external supplier that effectively has a huge program that crunches the numbers through a system for us. But those organizations that participate are required to and do inform, for example, their staff that the data is going to be used in that way, so that the staff that work there know what's happening with data that they have supplied to their employer. Tim, do you want to say a little bit more in terms of the detail of the process?
I think that's a fair synopsis, John, to be honest. It's all done on a web-based app with sort of banking-level security, so all the participating bodies would upload. Typically, it's the 30th of September this time round. So for the next exercise, it's data as at the 30th of September or the 6 months or 2-3 years before that period that's submitted. So we've got consistency in the periods that are being compared. And as John said, the computers and the algorithms run and produce match reports back to those bodies that they can access via the web-based app. It's then for them to prioritise those matches and to follow up in line with local priorities and risks, essentially.
Does it identify individuals who have committed fraud?
No, it matches things that are anomalies, which could indicate error, could indicate fraud. It's then a question of follow-up and investigation at a local level. As to whether or not it's error or fraud or a false match, if you like.
So does anyone get prosecuted as a result of this exercise?
Yes, sometimes.
Do you know how many?
Typically, it's not big numbers. I think last time round there were, I think, 4 or 5 referrals. I've not got numbers on referrals because investigations are still ongoing, but I'm told that there will be referrals to Procurator Fiscal for a couple of payroll cases, for example. Some of the cases may well be followed up down south. So where we have a match between a payroll for a body in Scotland and a payroll for a body in England, it's for the bodies to decide who follows up and pursues the fraud action. So we've got one that's been followed up in England, for example.
So is that 4 or 5 in Scotland or across the UK?
Well, that's just Scotland.
That's just Scotland. But I have to say, that doesn't sound very many, given the scale of the exercise.
Yeah, no, you're right. And I think that's sort of a more complex equation with backlogs and things hanging over from COVID, but traditionally it's never been particularly high, so I'm not sure this time around is unusual in that respect.
Okay. I'm happy to leave it there for now. Convenient.
Can I come back?
Of course, yes, please do.
I think there's two ways of looking at the exercise. It's one might be to look at the exercise to identify anomalies, identify fraud, and pursue data matches. The other way to look at the exercise is actually one as an assurance exercise of the level of data matches, potentially the level errors and fraud that aren't being picked up, and therefore assurance around actually what isn't wrong as opposed to what is wrong. So there's two ways of looking at the exercise from that perspective.
OK, thanks for that clarification. Can I just clarify a couple of things with you as well? I've variously seen that the number of participating bodies in this year's exercise was 110 or 127. Which is the correct number?
Tim?
Yeah, depends, again, statistics and it depends what you count. So the Scottish Government actually submit data on behalf of quite a number of central government bodies that are on their payroll and creditor systems. So if you count those separately, it's the higher figure. In terms of bodies actually submitting data in their own name, it's the lower figure.
Okay. Can I also ask you, I think in response to one of James Dornan's questions, you spoke about the reduction from 132 to 110 as being in part a reflection of pension schemes not taking part, or the classification of pension schemes being changed. I mean, if I look at, say, the Strathclyde local government pension scheme, which is worth £28 billion, it's one of the top 10 of all pension schemes across the UK. Incidentally, the university superannuation scheme, I think, comes top of that league. But Strathclyde, are you saying that was previously in the exercise and is no longer in the exercise?
No, that's not what we're saying at all, Convener. The data is still in the exercise, but Strathclyde Pension Fund is administered by Glasgow City Council. So in terms of counting the number of bodies, we might have just counted it as one body for both the City Council and the Pension Fund in terms of the data submission. So the data hasn't been excluded, it's just how we've counted the number of bodies.
So if you take that large municipal pension scheme, that is included in the exercise that you're carrying out.
Yes.
That's fine. Thanks, that's helpful. I'm going to invite Colin Beattie to put some questions to you. Colin.
Thank you, Convener. The 2022 report on the NFI talked about a consultation by the Cabinet Office on extending legal powers around the purposes for which data matching was used. Now, you're already covered under Section 97 of the Criminal Justice and Licensing Act 2010 for prevention and detection of crime other than fraud and to assist in the apprehension and prosecution of offenders. Is Audit Scotland satisfied at this moment that it has the necessary legislative powers to undertake this exercise effectively? Because this committee over a number of years has expressed concerns about the number of public bodies in receipt of large sums of money who don't participate, have determined not to participate on a voluntary basis. Could you maybe give us a little more information about what you would need? I mean, we have asked you actually directly in the past, every time a report's come up, what do you need in the way of legislative powers in order to extend the NFI more effectively in Scotland? And to be honest, the responses have been pretty ambivalent.
Okay. In terms of the current statutory powers, and I'll put my hands on the table and say I'm not a lawyer, but my view is that we have sufficient statutory powers to proceed with the exercise in a way that gives us the most economic and the most efficient outcome. I recognise that not all public bodies are mandated to participate, but that does not prevent us from working with those bodies to encourage participation and to grow the database of bodies that submit information. So as it stands at the moment, we are content to operate within the powers that we've got, and that enables us to move forward in a way that gives us access to those bodies that we would want to engage with and explore how best to pursue that engagement and to obtain the data.
I know that in the past Audit Scotland's expressed concern about having access to ALIOs. Now, I understand some ALIOs at least are now being caught up in this exercise. Can you maybe comment on where we are on that?
Tim knows more of the detail around that, but there is a growing number of ALIOs that are participating in the exercise, and what we start to see is that the parent organisation is not necessarily requiring, but strongly encouraging those ALIOs to participate on the grounds that all of the staff and all of the services are fundamentally linked to the parent organisation. And recognising the amount of money that is being pushed through ALIOs, both in terms of income and expenditure, there is a growing desire for the parent, by the parent bodies, for ALIOs to participate. Tim, I don't know if you know more of the detail.
Well, in terms of council ALIOs, we're at around half of all councils, roughly, include the data for their ALIOs. It does tend to come down a little bit to administrative arrangements. So, you know, where the payrolls and the creditor payment systems sit with the council, they've tended to include that data. So when we request payroll data, they would include payrolls for their ALIOs, for example. So, yeah, around about half of council allios we would capture. Those bodies are effectively voluntary participants. We don't appoint their auditors, so we can't mandate the inclusion of allios. So ultimately it comes down to administrative arrangements and convenience for the parent body and the relationship between the parent body and the allio, effectively, as to whether or not they volunteer to participate.
The fact is these allios are in receipt of very substantial sums of public funds, but you have no powers to mandate them to participate. Isn't that a shortfall in your legislative powers?
It comes back to Tim's point in terms of a lot of allios share the same systems and processes as the parent body, and therefore where that system works and where it's easy to submit the data, most parent bodies do submit it. What we haven't done, and perhaps what we need to think about, is actually quantifying not just the number of allios that participate, but the value of transactions that go through the allios. And it may well be that the number that participate represents the bulk of the transactions that pass through allios, and those that don't participate are smaller bodies. But we don't have that analysis, so that's something that we perhaps need to think about in terms of how we move forward with this.
What significant areas of expenditure, and I'm talking about expenditure that is useful to the NFI exercise, which significant areas at the moment are excluded or are poorly participating?
Tim, do you have a view on that?
I don't have that level of recall, unfortunately, but you know, we have been obviously in terms of wider public sector bodies, we've been liaising with the universities and RSLs, who are big employers, and obviously payroll data is one of the key data sets. Going beyond that, I think it's perhaps more problematic. I've not got the analysis, I'm afraid, in terms of wider public sector bodies that might be worth approaching and encouraging to participate at this stage. We'd started with the housing associations and universities as being the probably most likely to benefit and the most likely to add value to the exercise.
I think what's a little bit disappointing is we've been raising this as a committee for quite a few years now. We've never really had a solid response from Audit Scotland on whether it needs more powers granted to it to be able to enforce and mandate public bodies to participate in this quite important exercise. You say you've got enough powers, but you haven't actually analysed the market out there to determine where there are gaps that you would need to fill, which might need more powers. And those that are participating, you're talking about allios, only half the allios are taking part. It seems to me there's a lot of gaps, and either you're not using your present powers to the level that it should be, or you don't have the powers to do that, and therefore you need your hand strengthened.
We don't have the power to mandate participation for those bodies where we're not responsible for appointing the auditors. So as Tim has said, that excludes allios, universities and registered social landlords. There is an opportunity to pursue participation on a voluntary basis, which we do. There is a growing level of participation. Once we have clarified the position and the assurances around the GDPR requirements, we are confident of being able to engage with registered social landlords and the universities to bring those bodies within the remit of the NFI exercise. We continue to work with local authorities around allios, and there is a growing sense of the need to include allios in the exercise. My preference at the moment will be continuing with the approach that we currently have, with a view to being able to expedite that reasonably quickly to be able to get fuller participation. I think leaving aside the conversation around the number of bodies that we've talked about and how that's calculated, fundamentally, from our perspective, it's not just about the number of bodies. It's about how we can engage with them to get them to participate. And I'm confident that the approach that we're taking will see a growth in the level of participation.
Okay, if there's no changes, can you maybe say a little bit more about what's happening with the Cabinet Office in regard to delivering improved outcomes? Because they've presumably been working on this now for a couple of years. Where are we on this?
The Cabinet Office have a methodology that they apply universally across the UK, but that is tweaked in Scotland because there are slightly different arrangements and slightly different structures in place. So it's not a universal approach that's applied as a one-size-fits-all. The Cabinet Office work with us and other agencies, other public audit agencies, very closely to refine and develop the methodology with a view to both increasing the level of accuracy of the data that's collected and how it's analysed, but also to extend the methodology into other areas as appropriate. And it's that exercise that we're currently negotiating with the Cabinet Office on around the inclusion of registered social landlords and also universities.
I mean, the proof of the pudding, if you like, is in the eating. And you've got here an increase in outcomes from 14.9 million to 21.5 million. I mean, it's not a lot overall. You know, when you look at the whole exercise, but it has increased, and supposedly that's partly because of recovery from COVID-19, and you refer to some changes in methodologies. Can you maybe expand a bit more about that, the changes in methodologies that have led to this?
I'll hand over to Tim in a moment. Fundamentally, the change in the methodology is about assessing the notional values that are identified through the exercise. So the exercise identifies data matches at a particular point in time. It also risk assesses those data matches in terms of those that are more likely to be fraud and those that are more likely to either be errors in the matches or errors in the way the data is collected. The methodology itself, though, is trying to answer the question of what if. So in other words, if the error or the fraud hadn't been detected, what would be the value of fraud that would accumulate if it was allowed, or the value of error that would accumulate if it was allowed to continue? So it also tries to look into that sort of that future aspect in terms of the what-if question of what would accumulate. It also tries to better identify the cost of the error and better identify the cost of the fraud by being more sophisticated in its analysis. And that's fundamentally what's driven the growth in most of the value around the identified outcomes. But Tim, you understand this quite closely.
Yeah, thanks, John. In terms of individual methodologies and the methodologies around the estimates generally, the Cabinet Office has governance arrangements in place and there's a process that's gone through. We've always followed the Cabinet Office methodologies in terms of calculations and accepted their approach. There's forward savings periods, and then there's other methodologies for sort of quantifying notional outcomes. We've called them in the report, and we've tried to identify more clearly the different areas of saving and the types of outcome in exhibits 1 and 2 in the report.
Just also, we look at the participating bodies, and we see that a lot of them only submit payroll and creditors' data sets for matching. That obviously limits the outcomes that can be achieved. Does that mean there's scope for some public bodies? And maybe you can indicate which public bodies are only submitting that sort of data. Are there more data sets that they could submit? And if so, what are they and why aren't they doing it?
For public bodies, the majority of expenditure either goes through the payroll system or through accounts payable system, the creditors payment system. Generally speaking, for public bodies, payroll accounts for anywhere between 75 and 85% of total expenditure. So essentially, they are, from our perspective, they are the two core systems. If we can get the data for those systems, that means we cover most public sector expenditure that goes through the bodies. With councils, for example, there are slightly different systems that are fundamentally income-based systems. So we could do data matches around council tax, but also other income systems depending on the organisation. But fundamentally, the majority of expenditure is through payroll and creditor payments.
The size of the public sector spend. If the payroll's 85% of the budget, 15% is still an awful lot of money that we're missing out on digging into the NFI.
And fundamentally, most of that will go through the accounts payable system. So you can divide expenditure in most public bodies down into pay or non-pay, and virtually everything that's non-pay will go through the accounts payable or the creditors system.
So what other data sets would there be that could include?
There are some specific data sets that we look at. So, for example, blue badge schemes and how they're used. For example, around pensions, we look at whether pensions have continued to be paid after somebody has been deceased. And as I said, we look at council tax in terms of the revenue of council tax and single person discount. They're the key data sets that we look at. Tim, is there anything that...
We do sort of explore opportunities for new data sets all the time. So this time round, we rolled out adult concessionary bus travel, for example, and we matched that across Scotland for the first time. So that's an example where we're looking to grow the exercise through a sort of more diverse data sets. In the past, we've done pilot exercises with the NHS Account Fraud Service, for example, where we've looked at some prescriptions data. And we've done that as a one-off, and that's something we're looking to explore again with them to repeat that exercise. Bodies like Social Security Scotland, we've done pilot exercises with some of their data sets for benefits, for example, and we've got an ongoing relationship to do another pilot next year. So we do look. We encourage bodies to come forward with ideas and suggestions and to try new things in terms of data sets.
You talked previously that you risk assessed the different data sets that you were using. Now, given these some of these bodies are only submitting payroll and creditors data sets, you mentioned, for example, council tax among other data sets that could be provided. Surely that is an area which should have a high risk attached to it due to the potential for fraud. So shouldn't that be mandated as one of the data sets that has to be included?
Sorry, yes, it is. I was saying that they are data sets that are included.
So they are providing that?
So they are providing council tax data.
So it's not just payroll and creditor data sets?
No. It depends on the organisation. So you'd appreciate not every single public sector body is involved in council tax. That's specifically local
council
authorities.
Fee.
Yes.
And
yes.
They are 100%?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. I'll leave it at that.
If I may, convener, I think it's probably also important to recognise that NFI is not the only counter-fraud exercise that takes place. Tim has alluded to work that's undertaken by NHS counter-fraud, and they do a lot of work that is similar to the same sort of exercise as NFI. And there are other counter-fraud arrangements and other counter-fraud data matching exercises that take place in different organisations, primarily at an organisation level, but sometimes across organisations as well. So this exercise is probably more all-encompassing than others, but it is just one exercise and one tool in a suite of tools that different organisations use. So it's please don't see it as just the only thing that happens. There are other exercises as well.
Thanks. That's useful clarification. And we're going to get into some of the specific match areas shortly. But before we do that, I've got a couple of questions for you on the broader impact of the initiative. I think in Exhibit 3 in the report, you talk about the wider benefits of the National Fraud Initiative, in which you list that it can act as a deterrent to potential fraudsters, that it can provide assurance that systems are operating well and can also identify where system improvements are required. Could you tell us a bit more about that? I mean, what evidence have you got to support those claims that you make in the report?
Just running through them individually, acting as a deterrent, that has no direct evidence trail behind it. There is an element in that in terms of where publicity and being very open, transparent, and telling people about the exercise will deter people. Not necessarily deter people from committing fraud, but it will also prompt people as well to think about the accuracy of the data they have submitted, or whether they need to update their data or update their information for a change in circumstances. So it prompts a thought process. So that's fundamentally what we mean by a deterrent in terms of encouraging people to think about their information that has been submitted. It does provide assurance around systems and processes because it does identify weaknesses where they might exist at a local level. If an organisation gets a high number of data matches in a particular area, it prompts that organisation to look more closely and pursue that and follow that through. And that's something that's followed up by the local auditor and is generally reported on by the local auditor through their normal processes. And it also it provides assurance around where systems are working well, simply because of the absence of data matches, it gives you assurance that controls are operating effectively.
I mean, to what extent do you see this exercise as being one of catching fraud versus preventing fraud?
It's an interesting balance, because the challenge that we've got is with the data that's in here, it's difficult to say what is fraud and what is error, because all you have is a data match that could be either. My view is it's much more about the prevention agenda, and fundamentally because prevention is better than cure. And therefore, it's about preventing fraud from occurring. It's, as I said, it's about preventing people from making mistakes, forcing people to think about data that they've submitted. Is it up to date? Is it accurate? Does it need to be changed? So it's more the prevention that I think where it works best.
Okay. And who decided to call it the National Fraud Initiative?
I'm looking at Tim. That is... it's probably something that came about more than 20 years ago. The exercise was started by the Audit Commission in England, primarily as a data matching exercise, as it still is. I think I don't know who took the decision, but I think it was designed to increase and heighten awareness of the exercise and issue.
Okay, and add an element of menace, no doubt. Can I move us on to another part of the report, which struck me as being quite an important piece of analysis that you've presented to us, and that is contained in Exhibit 4, where you track over the last 5 years the performance of various bodies in taking action or having the ability to take action where errors or fraud is identified. And what's especially striking is the decline in satisfactory performance rates when I look in particular at local government and the National Health Service. So the kind of satisfaction rate in terms of how the systems are working, presumably, 5 years ago in local government was sitting at around 80%. It's now down to 60%. If I look at the NHS, broadly speaking, it was sitting 5 years ago at 95%. It's now sitting at 80% satisfaction rate. So there's been quite a considerable slippage there, hasn't there? Could you explain a bit more about what lies behind that?
there are fundamentally two issues that lie behind it. One is capacity and the ability to respond to the exercise, and particularly follow-up data matches. And linked to that, the second issue is fundamentally capability. It requires a very specific skill set to be able to follow up and pursue those data matches to their end point. And organisations that we work with are struggling to be able to service that in a way that we would rate it as being satisfactory. Please don't take unsatisfactory as an indication that organisations are doing nothing. All organisations are doing something. It's just that there is a distinction. It's an ability, the way we've set this out, is a distinction between the ability and the action that's taken by different organisations. But it doesn't suggest that nobody's doing nothing. Tim, are you able to add a bit more to that?
Yeah, I think fundamentally that's it. I mean, what we're hearing is, you know, that resources are a limiting factor with these things. And coming out of COVID, we actually expected participation to improve, and that's not the picture we've seen for the main players, as you identify. Councils and the NHS are key significant players for NFI. We've seen a decline in assessments from auditors.
Okay, and so to what extent is that a resource issue? You know, I mean, because we're dealing in an environment where the financial pressures on the health service and health boards is intensifying. The financial pressures on local councils and across local government is getting greater. So is it because they are unable to find the resources to follow up some of this work?
Yes, fundamentally. It's the availability of resources to follow up the work and at the same time pursue the other work that needs doing as part of somebody's normal day job. So it becomes that challenge and that balance.
And it's not an exercise that's self-financing. In other words, if I employ three people to follow this work up on salaries of £50,000 each or £60,000 each, would I not get that money back if, because of the work they were doing, would bring in revenue that had been paid out by error or was being paid out because of a fraudulent claim?
Not in all cases, no, convener.
But do bodies undertake that kind of cost-benefit assessment?
They do to varying degrees, but again, it comes back to our earlier conversation around actually needing to make an investment in deterrence, because deterrence doesn't happen by itself and it doesn't happen by accident. You actually need to take positive action in response to that. So there's that unknown element in terms of, if I've deterred somebody from committing a fraud, I actually never know how much I've deterred them from committing fraud. So it's that balance in terms of it's an investment, but you never really know what the investment on the return on investment is.
Okay. I mean, and earlier on, I think you described it as something that we should view as a one-off exercise or a point-in-time exercise. But you also presumably have, I think you even mentioned it in the report, you've got kind of an ongoing relationship with the bodies that you're working with on the National Fraud Initiative. So could you tell us a little bit more about the dynamics of that, how that works, and what you're doing to monitor the impact of the activity that you're undertaking on this exercise?
So there's two elements to that, convener. As part of our normal audit process, you may be aware that we not just undertake an audit of the financial statements, but we also have a wider scope element to our work, which looks at arrangements and processes in place within individual bodies. Part of that work looks at governance arrangements, looks at control arrangements, and looks at arrangements for preventing and detecting fraud. So there's an assessment there of the body's ongoing work and the body's ongoing arrangements, controls and processes. So we look at that as part of our normal work. And then every 2 years when this work comes through, we actually look at and assess how the organisation has followed up the data matches, how they've participated in the exercise, the governance and control processes that they've put in place around the exercise. And that's summarised in Exhibit 4. As part of that as well, you'll be aware that most public bodies, if not all public bodies, have an internal audit function. Part of their work will be to look at arrangements within the organisation to prevent and detect fraud. And again, we review the work of internal audit on a regular basis as part of the audit that we undertake. In the NHS, you've got the NHS Counter Fraud Service. So again, although we don't review the work of the NHS Counter Fraud Service, we will come to a view as to how the organisation, the health board, is working with the Counter Fraud Service to be able to pursue the work that they undertake. So it falls through in our normal work on quite a regular and quite a succinct basis.
Okay, thanks for that. We want to spend a bit of time going into some of these specific areas which you drilled down into, and to get us underway on that, I'm going to invite Graeme Simpson to put some questions to you. Graeme.
Thanks, Convener. But before I do that, if we could just follow up on the Convener's line of questioning, and it sparked a thought from me, and I suppose it goes back to what I was asking earlier. What would you say, I mean, what's the point, what's the benefit to a public body of being part of this exercise? What do they get from it?
It comes back to the exhibit that Convener highlighted in the report, Exhibit 3, around the deterrence, the assurance around controls in place, but also the improvement areas that are identified. And it allows, if we go back to the conversation we had around scarce resources and the utilisation of resources, it allows those resources or provides an indication of where those resources could be deployed in order to have the most effect and give the biggest outcome. So it provides a multiple range of benefits to organisations.
So would you say that it is pointing organisations in the right direction as to, you know, how to identify individuals who are maybe committing fraud or how to prevent fraud happening?
I think it does both. I think it does prevent, it does point organisations in the directions of individuals that would be named through the exercise. It also highlights the types of fraud that are being committed, so it enables organisations to reevaluate whether they have appropriate controls and processes in place to prevent that fraud. And it also enables organisations effectively to highlight that they will actively pursue fraud or actively pursue error with a view to taking it through to its logical conclusion, whether that's an improvement in systems or, as you alluded to earlier on, whether that eventually ends up in a prosecution of individuals.
Okay. Has there ever been a cost-benefit analysis of the National Fraud Initiative?
Yeah, we're required to keep the costs and benefits under review. It's a tricky one because much of the time that goes in terms of follow up of matches is not overtime, if you like. It's normally part of someone's job. So, you know, someone within the creditor's payment team, for example, within the payroll section, would be charged with reviewing and following up matches as appropriate. So it's not always additional cost, and time isn't always coded to the exercise. So we've never really been able to get sort of a total cost or a marginal cost on a scientific basis. But I think the sort of scale of the savings that we identify is significant, and most of the bodies that have attended our practitioner events that we've organised and have been asked the question, you know, do you think the benefits still outweigh the costs? And this is for bodies even where they don't identify savings, you know, they get that assurance and they get that deterrent effect. You know, resoundingly, it's yes, we think the benefits outweigh the costs. So it's a little bit an anecdotal, so please don't ask me what the total cost would be, but I guess the point is that they're not additional costs in most cases. It's part of someone's day job, which is why we have the challenge around resources. So some bodies do have corporate fraud officers, and, you know, there's an NHS Counter Fraud Service as well who do get involved in investigations for NHS and some of the central government bodies.
So do you not have the total cost of the exercise?
Bodies simply don't code time to the exercise. You know, timesheets aren't done to that degree of granularity to identify what a total quantum of cost would be. But as I say, if they weren't doing the NFI, they would be doing something else. It's not overtime, generally speaking. It's not additional cost to a body to participate.
I'm a bit surprised at that, to be honest. I would have thought that an exercise such as this, you would know how much it's costing and what the value is of it.
We're dependent on participating bodies' information systems for that, and they simply don't record the costs.
Is that not something that should be considered going forward, do you think?
We can consider that to take forward.
Okay. The convener wants me to ask about specific areas, so I'm quite happy to do that. So if we look at payroll, there's been an issue with including or not including immigration data, and I noted that it hadn't been included in 2 years, 2018-19 and 2020-21, and you had some comments on that. What would be the value, do you think, of including that sort of data?
Tim?
Well, the immigration data was sort of typically would identify where someone's working illegally, effectively. And that was in 16-17, most of the matches would have been immigration data matches, in all honesty. But following Windrush, the Home Office decided to pull that data set and match, and we've not matched it since. And I'm not aware of, well, it certainly won't be part of the 24-25 exercise either. So I think that's the immigration data sort of
issue. So is that because of the Home Office?
Yes.
They just won't share the information?
Yeah. I don't know the ins and outs of the discussion, but I understand that it was following the Windrush.
I think you've commented previously that, you know, for example, it could help identify students who are getting funding from the Student Awards Agency when they're not entitled to it. That's quite important, isn't it?
It is, but we're only able to work with the data that we're provided with, and it requires participating bodies, particularly central government bodies, to submit that sort of data.
Has anyone pushed the Home Office on this?
We certainly haven't. I don't know whether...
You haven't?
No, I don't know whether the Cabinet Office have.
Right, I wonder if... It does seem really important, this information. I think just to accept the situation, just to accept what the Home Office is saying is maybe not the right approach. Maybe somebody should be going back to them and saying, well, actually, this information is almost vital to this exercise. So could you provide it? Test them again.
I'm sure there would have been a long and extensive discussion around this. I think there's a legislative... the legislation in England is a little bit different as well, and the central government departments, as I understand it, participate on a voluntary basis because of historic reasons around the legislative framework. So I don't think the Cabinet Office are able to mandate their involvement or submission of data. I guess that's a policy issue at a higher level.
At least they could ask.
We can find out if they have. I'm sure there would have been. It was always a very rich source of data matching, to put it that way. I'm sure it wouldn't have been given up lightly.
Yeah. Okay. I'll ask you about something else then. The council tax reduction scheme. So before I ask you a specific question about that, do councils generally share information? Do they talk to each other in terms of council tax? I was thinking we've got now in Scotland a large number of councils who charge double council tax if you have a second home. Now that relies on people being honest about them having a second home. But it seems to me that it would be easier to discover that if councils spoke to each other actually across the UK. Does that happen?
It does. And I know that councils do speak to each other and do share data, but I don't think the framework is all-encompassing that enables that to happen on a routine basis across all councils. But it does happen to a certain extent.
But would that be picked up in this exercise?
The data matches would pick that up, yes.
They would, okay. So just on the council tax reduction scheme, case numbers, this is quite interesting, case numbers have reduced since 2020-21, yes. But the savings have actually gone up. Do you know why that would be the case?
Tim?
No. Only, it would come down to the incidence of individual cases, I guess, and how long those cases have been going on. So essentially that's what's driving the numbers is the council tax reduction that's been withdrawn, essentially, relative to those cases. So it may well be, for example, that during COVID there wasn't as much activity in this area and that cases could have been going on for longer.
Okay. I'll move on from that. I'm going to ask about a couple of other areas. They are actually linked, I think, blue badges and concessionary travel. So on blue badges, the blue badge outcomes and case numbers they've just continued to go up. And when we looked at this in 2022, it was suggested to us it could have been a blip due to the COVID-19 pandemic. But do you ever get any ideas why the case numbers and the outcomes might have continued to rise? So this is people who are using blue badges when they shouldn't.
I think this is one of those where ordinarily, day-to-day administration of blue badges would involve, counselling badges as they're picked up, via Telus Once and schemes like that with the registrars. I don't think you can extrapolate from the actual numbers of badges cancelled to anything that's necessarily related to mortality rates, for example. It could just reflect the fact that some councils are maybe relying more heavily on the NFI to mop up and to do their sort of data cleansing, as it were, and maybe the day-to-day, week-to-week activity has maybe suffered in a period of great strain within the public sector during COVID, for example. So that's probably my take on it. There's one or two more councils, I think, have recorded their outcomes on the web-based application for NFI. So I don't think we've had a 100% sort of compliance in terms of recording outcomes previously. And this time around, it's not 100%. We may be missing one or two councils who've simply not recorded the results of their activity on the system.
I mean, it's always gone on. You've always had, people using blue badges when they really ought not to. Do these figures suggest that it's rather too easy to get away with that?
It requires a degree of honesty on behalf of the family of the deceased individual. There is an element where a lot of local authorities use the system of tell us once, and you inform them somebody's deceased, and then they relate to the relevant services and stop the various systems that would prevent this sort of thing from happening. That's reliant upon the individual using the tell us once system. And I think there's an extent where, if I'm being candid, if somebody has deceased, dealing with the blue badge is not necessarily the first priority that people will deal with. So there's a degree of sensitivity that we need to apply around this. But there is, I think, an option for encouraging using tell us once, but also reminding people of the responsibilities that they have around the blue badge scheme. So I think it's a sensitive area, There is a growth in the area that you've highlighted. I think also it's important to remember that the outcomes are notional, and they will increase. In very simplistic terms, outcomes will increase if car parking charges increase, because the value associated with the use of the blue badge increases as well. So there are a number of factors that play into this, but fundamentally it relies on the honesty of the individual to make the declaration.
And that brings me on to adult concessionary bus travel, which has the same issue, because I think you're right, John, that when somebody dies, you've got a lot to deal with, and probably dealing with a blue badge or a bus pass is quite down in your list of priorities. However, in this report, 1,075 people or passes have been used. This is a bus pass after somebody had died. So that's clearly fraudulent. That's using a dead person's bus pass. So that's not just forgetting to tell somebody.
Yes, I agree.
So do you think? I mean, presumably that figure's been picked up in this exercise. Yeah. Are there things that, as a result of this, Transport Scotland could be doing to crack down on that, so that we don't have this level of ears fraud?
This comes back to the conversation we had before in terms of the value of the exercise. So this is the sort of thing that would highlight where organisations, whether it's Transport Scotland or a local authority, would need to take further action to prevent misuse of concessionary travel passes. Again, it is incredibly difficult in terms of relying on the honesty of the individual, but to a certain extent relying on the bus driver to identify that the photograph on the pass does not necessarily match the individual that swiped it. So there are a number of factors that play into this. I think the key thing is you're probably never ever going to eradicate it. The best you can do is to make sure that the controls and processes you've got in place, the use of the data that you have access to, is you make the best use of that as possible. So that if somebody does continue to use a concessionary pass, travel pass, that's either stopped immediately or stopped as soon as you possibly can. And that, again, relies upon being able to use different systems and accessing the data and the honesty of the individuals concerned. So, yes, is the short answer. There is an opportunity to always improve controls.
Yeah. Okay, convener, thank you.
Okay, thank you. I think James Donner wanted to come in on the blue badge question.
Thank you, convener. Just very briefly, can I just clarify the blue badge thing is not really about fraud, because you haven't proven any fraud. It's more about the fact that passes haven't been cancelled after the death of somebody. There's no evidence to suggest that these badges continue to be used.
Yes, that's absolutely the issue. I think there are some cases where authorities have proven that the badges have continued to be used, but that would not necessarily be captured through the data matching exercise. It's more about the cancellation of the badges. Tim, I don't know if I've got that absolutely right.
Yeah, essentially that's the methodology. It's I guess at some stage the multiplier which the Cabinet Office used to sort of put against the cancellation would have included a sort of incidence of fraud type element, So it's a proxy ultimately. And it would have been based on all sorts of things like levels of income, as John mentioned, but also there would have been some evidence around incidents of fraud that would have been factored into that.
For that. I'm now going to ask the Deputy Convener to put some questions to you, Jamie.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, gentlemen. I'll try and keep this fairly brief, but I'll follow on to a couple of areas in your report that were of interest to me. But first of all, maybe an overarching question, and that's, so just to get my head around this, Audit Scotland undertakes the work of the NFI in Scotland. Is that on behalf of the Public Sector Fraud Authority or contracted by the Public Sector Fraud Authority? What is your relationship to the body that oversees the UK-wide NFI?
Tim?
The exercise is undertaken using Audit Scotland statutory powers, so ultimately it wouldn't happen if it wasn't for Audit Scotland. But obviously the infrastructure and an element of the support arrangements is provided by the NFI team, who Cabinet Office / Public Sector Fraud Authority. So I guess we're a partner in terms of the UK-wide exercise, but we're a key player. It wouldn't happen without Audit Scotland statutory powers.
Does Audit Scotland charge fees for that work?
No, in terms of we get charged fees. So the Cabinet Office are the main contractor with our data matching provider. We are charged for each of the bodies that participate in Scotland, and that comes out of the Audit Scotland budget. Historically, I think we were voted an allocation to cover the cost of this exercise. It's a little bit different than down south, where the individual bodies that are participating and benefiting would pay the fee direct, but it's just a little bit more straightforward to meet it centrally.
Okay, so I'm just trying to get my head around this flow. So if you're, for example, a Scottish local council, do you pay a fee to participate in this? You don't. So any benefits that are recouped, and I'll come on to an example in a second, particularly housing benefit, any saving, you call them savings, your identification of savings is the identification of the value of fraud, essentially. But we'll call it savings for now. But to ensure that, by participating in the initiative, there is a potential upside of identifying these so-called savings, but there's no cost of charge to them. Is that correct?
There's no cost in terms of a fee. There is a cost in terms of the resource time that it takes to follow up and investigate, but there is no price that is charged for participation.
Okay. Are there any local authorities in Scotland that do not participate in the NFI?
No.
They all do?
They all do.
Okay. So I'm presuming the media article that I came across in my research ahead of today was erroneous in its claim that Perth and Kinross Council is one of, it says, I quote, two UK local authorities which do not share electoral roll data with the NFI. Is that true or is that an incorrect article?
Tim?
No, that's correct. They participate in the exercise and they have a sort of separate arrangement in place for council tax single person discount, so they don't use the NFI in that respect, and I think that's true for the two councils that you mentioned there.
Okay, would there be any reason why they wouldn't? I'm not picking on them, it's just that they flagged as the only one in Scotland that doesn't.
Yeah, well, there's two councils that their legal teams, their interpretation of the legislation and their conclusion was that they didn't think it appropriate or didn't think it legal to submit the electoral register data. It's a long-running sort of conversation that we revisit every time, you know. But essentially, that's peculiar to those two councils, and it's not in line with our interpretation of legislation.
Okay, that's maybe something we can follow up with COSLA, for example, as a body which assists and represents number of local authorities in Scotland.
So they would use a separate arrangement with a separate provider. For example, in the case of Perth and Kinross, they use a third-party provider to do the canvas and the follow-up work, and they choose not to use NFI.
Okay. On page 3 of your report, in the opening key messages, there are 3 key messages. I was particularly struck by number 2. And if I can point your attention to the last sentence in that. And maybe you can explain and clarify a little bit as to what it means and why. You summarise by saying, overall, it is not clear whether underlying levels of fraud have increased since 2020-2021. That flags me as a point of concern. But I'll give you an opportunity to perhaps clarify what you mean by that.
Okay. The exercise is predominantly a data matching exercise. Simply because there is a data match, it does not mean that there has been fraud. So, for example, if you identify that one individual was on 2 different payrolls for 2 different organisations, that can be entirely legitimate because somebody can have 2 jobs. But you have a data match that's flagged through the exercise. there is also an element of this where different organisations will take a different view as to whether a particular event or particular data match is fraud, depending upon the evidence that's available to them and depending on the work that they've undertaken to be able to investigate that. And it could well be that you have two events that are the same in two different organisations. In one organisation, you have sufficient evidence to meet the threshold of fraud, but in another organisation, you don't. But that doesn't mean to say that it wasn't fraud. You just don't have the evidence to prove it. So there's an element here where you end up, and this might sound a bit odd, but you end up in a situation where determining whether something is fraud can become subjective and judgmental. So consequently, we are reluctant to label anything that is an increase in data matches as simply an increase in fraud. It could just be an increase in error. It could be an improvement in the quality of the data. It could be an increase in the amount of data or the number of data sets that are submitted. So it's very difficult to prove causality between an increase in data matches and an increase in the level of fraud.
But by default, in that same paragraph, you say that savings, to use that phrase, have increased from around 15 million to over 21 million across a short space of time. So there is an increase in the value of the activity, but that doesn't necessarily say that there's an increase in fraud during activity. It's just the value.
Yes, that's absolutely right.
And it's not always fraudulent activity that you flag up. So, for example, in the case of bodies that do participate in the NFI will submit data sets that presumably your analysis will flag up things like duplicate payments, for example. The report says that around £750,000 worth of duplicate creditor payments were, for example, identified. Do you know then how much of that actually was erroneous, or were there amount of these that were simply identified as duplicate matches of data but actually were valid? As you say, for example, you could buy a £2,000 laptop from a creditor and the next day do exactly the same thing again.
Yes.
And that would be flagged perhaps as an erroneous payment, a potential fraud, or just an error, or actually a valid payment made by a body. So what work do you do thereafter to say whether the value in that data identification was then matched and married with what happened next, the follow-up activity?
So we don't pursue that to that level of detail. There is a distinction between the roles and responsibilities and the accountability for the individual body and the role of the auditor. Fundamentally, it's for the individual body to pursue that and to identify whether it was a mistake, error, or fraud. That would be reported through the individual body's own processes and systems, and it's never something that's flagged back through the NFI process.
I guess where I'm heading with all this is doesn't all this whole conversation, what it strikes me this morning is that perhaps where there is a failing in this whole process, which would help you in your opening key message to move from saying it is not clear whether fraud is increased or not, to get to a position where you can take a more definitive view on it by having done the work that identifies the savings, having fed all that back to the bodies involved, let them do their thing in identifying what is fraud, what is valid, what is erroneous, what are systems issues or manual issues, and then feed that back to you so that you can then insert another section into future reports that say, having identified these savings, this is what we think the outcomes were. I appreciate that's an extra piece of work for you, maybe even outside of your statutory requirements. But would that give people more confidence that the work that you're doing has more value if there was an extra piece of analysis done in terms of the... Do you see where I'm going with
this? Yes, I understand exactly where you're going with this. I think that's something we'd have to take away and look at in terms of understanding how that process might work and how burdensome that might become on individual bodies in order to provide that data back. But we can certainly take that away and look at that.
That would be good. Thank you. Yeah. Two quick ones. Housing benefits and pensions are quite big pieces of work as part of the initiative. I perhaps didn't understand some of the terminology. There's a lot of jargon in this report. Talk me through what it means when you say that the average individual value of overpayments for housing benefit rose from just over £2,000 to £6,500 over a short period of time. Is this to do with the value of payments? Is it to do with the level of potential fraud? I appreciate there's been a marked shift since 2018 of having a bespoke housing benefit payment to universal credit, for example, which has perhaps mopped up some of these more individual benefits. But I couldn't quite get my head around what the situation was with housing benefit fraud, whether you've identified a rise or decline or so on.
Okay, Tim, you able to?
Yeah, I don't think we do identify an average value, and we're not able to identify an average value, largely because we don't have the data from the DWP. So the way housing benefits matches work is that most of the council sort of benefits investigation staff transferred to DWP sort of 8 or 9 years ago, and they're responsible for following up fraud cases now. So when a council gets their match reports back from the exercise, they would identify if they think there's a fraud involved, and they would refer that to the DWP, and then the DWP would follow it up and investigate. And we include the savings, but they're not identified back to a council by council basis. So we just get a total saving figure, and we don't get a case count figure for that. So that's the reason we've not included a sort of average value, if you like, for housing benefit claims or housing benefit cases that were identified as error or fraud.
If there's fraudulent housing benefit claims, and that's picked up through the work that you do, you tell the DWP about that, or do you tell the local authority?
The council basically are responsible for follow-up at the matches, so they'll receive a report back, a number of reports back in actual fact, for housing benefits matched to various things. Now, where there's... They tend to be classed as fraud, claimant error, or local authority error,
right,
essentially. So where there seems to be a fundamental issue and they're classed as fraud, they're just referred to the DWP, so the council would just refer, and the following investigation and follow-up would be done by the DWP. They then identify an overpayment amount, which is then attributed to the Scottish pot of outcomes, if you like, but not to the council pot of outcomes. And ultimately, I guess it's a saving for the DWP, because they fund housing benefits, essentially.
So there's no, just to be clear, there's no clawback from local authorities or any payments to local authorities from DWP. Is that your understanding?
The only sort of saving, if you like, to the individual councils is where there's a follow-up of a claim and error, and they can recover that money locally, then that accrues to the council. But the amounts involved are not significant. They're not, you know, they're a small proportion of the total HB outcomes that we've identified in the report.
Okay. Would you think that you add value to the work that in-house fraud teams do? I presume the DWP has a massive fraud team across the whole wide, as is the HMRC and other big bodies across the UK who manage very large sums of money for large sums of people. I presume they've got reams of people sitting in an office looking at fraud. So your small team, what value add do you give to any of this?
Well, a large part of my role is if you like, supporting the auditors, but also supporting the practitioners. It's a sort of dual role, if you like. So I think we included an exhibit in the report that looked at the sort of key determinants of effective delivery, Exhibit 5. We did a triangle with leadership, knowledge, and resources. Now, there's not much we can do about resources other than, you know, I can support key contacts who are responsible at bodies that are maybe struggling a little bit. If we have a new key contact, I can offer a higher level of support to bring them up to speed, to improve that sort of local knowledge, if you like, around what's an effective approach, what's a good use of time. So I spend quite a bit of time doing that, in all honesty. We organise practitioner events as well. So that's sort of what we bring to the party, if you like, is we supplement the support that the Cabinet Office provides. I think I like to say we go a little bit further and we organise sort of focus groups, workshops and one-to-one support at a local level for key contacts and the practitioners that are following up certain match areas.
Yeah, thank you. Two slightly random questions, perhaps. One is there a, with the advancement of the ability to read, if you like, calculate data using artificial intelligence, have you seen much of a move over the last 5 years? That's a side of audit which we've talked about often, and the potential benefits from it in speeding up processes, but improving the quality of analysis as well, but also, you know, effectively putting, you know, nice, well-paid auditors out of work at some point. Is there any potential advantages to the use, further use of AI in the work that you do in identifying large amounts of data from over nearly 120 public bodies all submitting data in different forms and different formats and using different technologies?
I'm going to give a typical auditor's answer to that, and it depends. And I think there's a number of factors with that. The system that we currently use is based upon algorithms. It's based upon analysis of data at high speed and making the matches. The next step in this is actually through the use of AI, because AI is contingent on the basis that the system learns. So if you're able to implement AI around this sort of data matching exercise, then theoretically the system should learn from the data matches that have been identified to retarget the analysis in a different way. Now, that's something that we have not pursued yet, and it's something that I think is still under investigation in terms of, is there an added value for that, or does the simple algorithm that's currently used provide the value that's needed? So I think it's fair to say that the jury's still out, but it hasn't been discounted in terms of how the process might grow and evolve in the future. And I think that the biggest area, it comes back to some of the earlier questions, is actually AI would have the ability to fill data gaps with proxy data and would therefore enable you to either think again about where you needed to target your resources to investigate and follow up, or think again about the adequacy of controls and processes that are in place to target those areas that are most susceptible. So I think there's an area for development, but it's just a very, very early stage at this point.
Do you not feel like perhaps the industry is a bit behind the curve in that respect? And other people are already making extensive use of AI in their business processes.
I think the challenge is AI is moving on at such a pace that had we taken the decision to invest in AI around this, let's say 12 months ago, it probably would already be out of date because of the way, the speed that AI is developing. There's an element of which we're actually, we need to take a decision about now is the right time to invest. And fundamentally, I don't think we're there yet in terms of, I don't think the approach to AI has fully developed in a way that allows us to invest now and future-proof it for 12, 18 months, 2 years down the line.
I'm sure when the Auditor General comes knocking on the CPA's door for more money, that'll be part of his pitch. Can I ask one final one? Are you doing anything that's in relation to COVID-related fraud? Obviously, there's been a lot of noise around the potential scale, volume and value across many different aspects of COVID, but particularly around the work of HMRC in terms of loans, grants, etc. But there may be other bodies which you do work for who have been affected by COVID fraud, to use that phrase.
We haven't, and the NFI exercise doesn't include any specific element that is purely COVID-related, but it's inbuilt into the existing data matches. So, for example, if organisations have paid out COVID-related grants, they've generally gone through the accounts payable, the creditors system, so the data would be included within that data set. Similarly, if there are issues around funding that was available to cover payroll costs during COVID. That would come through the data matches from payroll. So we haven't identified COVID-19 payments specifically, but they're inherent within the data sets that we've got.
Okay, thank you, Gary.
Thank you. And it's useful that we've finished up on that point this morning, because what I was going to ask was a kind of broader question, which is a lot of the emphasis this morning, a lot of the discussion that we've had has been around individual citizens defrauding the state. But there are also instances of corporations potentially defrauding the state, are they? And whether it's PPE equipment or others. I mean, in September 2022, the last time we had evidence on the National Fraud Initiative, we were told of instances where people passed away in care homes. The council was not notified, and so they continued to pay fees for people in care homes. And so my first question then is that still being monitored?
It's picked up through the data matching exercise that we've got. We're also very aware there's a lot of authorities put stringent controls in place around notifying them of deceased individuals in care homes. So we know arrangements and controls have been strengthened, and it's inherent within the data set that we use. Tim, do you want to add to that?
Yeah, I think that's true. I mean, we used to take a specific data set for care home and personal care payments. We haven't been taking that data set for the last couple of exercises because of sort of a technicality of an unintended consequence of legislation, shall we say. We hope to be able to reinstate that data set for matching purposes going forward, but we're waiting on a legislative reform order. It is the route they've gone down at Westminster, which will amend the offending legislation to make it okay for us to... it was quite a technical thing, but we weren't able to return the information to councils. So councils were submitting the data set, we could match it, but the legislation said we could only return it to an NHS body and not to the council. So it was an oversight, unintended consequence of legislation. So we hope to be doing that one at some stage as soon as that reform order goes through.
Okay. And a final question from me. We discussed earlier on the adult concessionary bus travel arrangements. And Graeme Simpson spoke about over 1,000 people who had used the bus passes of people who deceased. I think it's fair for the record to say that was out of 99,600 people. In other words, 99% of the population are entirely honest. And let's get some perspective on that. I just wondered, though, as well, the extent to which you monitor the bus operators themselves. You know, because there are... interesting areas around whether the journeys charged for are actually the journeys which people have actually taken. You know, is there a mismatch? I think, for example, when you get off the bus, you're supposed to swipe your card to say, this is the stop I'm getting off at. If you don't do that, what's the default position? Is it that you get the bus operator charges for a longer journey? So I just wonder whether these fall within the remit of the National Fraud Initiative or whether that's looked at somewhere else.
I don't think it is included within NFI, no. But Tim?
No, that type of analysis, as I understand it, is undertaken by Transport Scotland. Obviously, this could dovetail with that in some way, depending on, you know, patterns of usage of passes, for example. But no, it's not part of the NFI matching. We simply do a sort of mortality screening, if you like, which is, live bus passes to deceased records, essentially. And we flag that up as a data set. The follow-up is an investigation is then done by Transport Scotland.
I was going to say on that jolly note, we'll draw proceedings to a close, but I noticed that James Dawn has got one final question to put to you.
Thank you. Yeah, it was based on something that Jamie was talking about earlier on. And you mentioned that, correct me if I'm wrong here, I might have got it wrong, because I didn't think that you identified fraud and told them. You said that you matched data sets, told them about the discrepancies. But when we're talking about housing benefit... I thought you said that you either identified fraud or one or two other ways, and then it went straight to the DWP.
No, it's the same process where we identify the data match, but the DWP has the classification of whether it's fraud, claimant error, or local authority error. So we provide the data, but it's DWP that provide that classification.
So depending on the classification you send back, then it would trigger an investigation by DWP?
Yes. Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thanks very much indeed, and thank you for providing us with a very useful session this morning. I think we are ourselves legislators, and there are some points at which we've strayed into areas where legislation might need to be amended. So there are certain things we will need to consider, as well as perhaps things that you will consider as a result of this morning's session. But can I thank John Connett and Tim Bridle for your time and contributions this morning. You've given us a few things to think about, and it allows us to make comparison between this exercise and the previous one 2 years ago, and to give consideration as to whether we might want to make some suggestions of areas that could be covered that currently are not, or bodies that really ought to be a part of this initiative but perhaps currently are not. So can I thank you very much indeed, and I will now move the committee into private session.